My childhood was a pretty ordinary one. Happy, undistinguished for the most part. Except I knew early on what I wanted to be, a filmmaker. I didn't really know why I was interested in film, but as I grew older and started making films, I eventually found the answer. This is Icon, a nightclub in downtown Orlando, Florida, where I came a few years ago to study film in college. And this is Mark Snyder, aka Remark, an up-and-coming local DJ. He spins at Icon every Friday night. He's also got a college radio show and manages a dance music store in town. He's agreed to help me make a documentary about dance music. Filmmaking interests me because it helps me answer difficult questions. For instance, why would anybody ever want to go into a club and listen to pounding music at 3 o'clock in the morning? In Orlando, it definitely isn't for the beer. Clubs are required to stop serving alcohol at 2 a.m. The draw is not the opposite sex, either. Late night, the clubs are so dark inside, you can hardly see anybody else's face. Some people insist the draw is the drugs, but my experience is different. Drugs are limited to a small minority. People are coming to the clubs for the music, dance music. I know because I often go to a club at 3 o'clock in the morning to listen to it. What I don't know is why I'm so attracted to it. So, in my typical way, I've decided to pick up a camera and start shooting, to find out. And no better place to do it than my adopted town. When you think of Orlando, Disney World is probably what comes to mind. Orlando has more theme parks and hotel rooms than any other city in the world. But something escapes most visitors. Out beyond the tacky neon blaze of the shopping malls and tourist traps, there's a city with personality, a place where real people live, and dance music thrives there. Orlando likes to call itself the City Beautiful, and that's really not a stretch. Commerce and agriculture have proven strong enough to raise skyscrapers all over our downtown, miles away from any of the theme parks. With a population quickly approaching 300,000, Orlando is one of the fastest growing cities in the country. There's a never-ending array of construction work. Every day a new structure pops up somewhere. A few signs suggest Orlando might be growing a little too fast, but overall, I find it a very livable city. To me, what's most interesting about this growth is the uneasy wave of liberalism that's cresting here. There are young professionals from bigger cities moving in all the time, and they have created a demand for alternative cultural options that Orlando hasn't always been eager to supply. Truth be told, this is a very conservative community, headquarters to organizations like Campus Crusade for Christ and the Christian Coalition of Florida. So in that regard, Orlando's not exactly the spot where you predict a nationally recognized dance music scene. Yet here it is.
House music started about 1990 in Orlando at the club Oz, which carried on with the club Edge in probably 1992 or so. And I'd say that the Edge and Oz were, for the most part, the ones that pretty started the scene here in Orlando. That was carried on in 1994 by Firestone opening and Oz's closing. And then Firestone pretty much continued to be the location to bring in international talent, international DJs from all over the world. And that is what carried house music into the forefront in Orlando.
What used to be the Edge is now a country music club in the very heart of downtown. As for Oz, it's become a tacky mainstream club called Zuma Beach.
Firestone originally opened in 1993 as an all-gay club, and ever since then, it kind of took advantage of its size and its capacity, and it became a mixed club, and has ever since been basically the pioneer in Orlando as far as clubs to bring house music and internationally known DJs to Orlando. And even today, it still is the biggest and most well-known club in Orlando.
Orlando has beautiful sunsets. For some, they signal the end of the day. But for a host of others, it's only the beginning. Orange Avenue is the place to be on Saturday night. It's clean, it's safe, and there's plenty to do. Dozens of bars, restaurants, and clubs are located within the space of a few city blocks, and they attract thousands of people to the area. Don't look too hard for teenagers, though. They have a curfew. You see mostly young adults, the type that doesn't come out until later in the evening. At 11 o'clock, the clubs are still empty. The dance music is already in the air.
For those of you who are just tuning in, WPRK 91.5 FM, the voice of Rollins College. My name is Remark. You're about to tune in to Remarkable for the next hour and 45 minutes, roughly. I will take you on a cool little journey. The first hour is going to be cool, housey, groovy, kind of smooth, awesome kind of house kind of stuff. And the second hour is going to be some stomping hard progressive house that I have not been able to throw down in quite some time. And it's going to be a little mix of the old, a little mix of the new.
Mark's college radio show is called Remarkable. It's been charging Orlando airwaves with dance music for 6 years. Tonight he has some guests in the studio.
How do you want this announced? Brand new music right there from Orlando's and Rollins' very own Lance Cashin, who's in the studio right now. That's his new track called Maxim. Very cool tune there, and he's in the studio. He wants to say, what's up?
Good clubs and DJs like Mark have helped to make dance music popular in Orlando. But what's really created the vibrant scene here is the surprising number of local artists creating original music. Orlando exports dance music and DJs all over the country, and even abroad.
I joined the Rollins staff, PRK staff, in September of 91, and got my show within about a month. And originally, my show wasn't as dance music oriented as it is now. It took me a while to get to that status, to get that kind of respect, if you will. But finally, I did, and in about a year after I joined on, and I got my own show that was all dance music. And ever since then, I've been involved, and it's been about 6 years now that I've been involved at the station.
Mark actually graduated from Rollins College a few years ago, honors with a degree in philosophy. But the popularity of his show has allowed him to continue spinning in the school station.
When I'm out at a club, I usually am looking for dance floor response, and there's a certain sound people are expecting to hear from Remark. There's a certain kind of feel that they're expecting, and there's a certain kind of vibe that I want to create. On my radio show, I'm able to kind of make my own vibe. I can determine what I'm feeling and use that to set the mood for the radio show. So I can do everything from progressive house to deep house to funky house to hard house to high energy house, and it's just kind of a mixture of it all. And that's one of the unique things about my show. I'm not relying on a dance floor to give me feedback. Instead, I'm just kind of relying on where the music takes me. And that's one of the most exciting things about being down here, is that it's just a really exciting creative process. I will be back here next Saturday night. My name is Remark, and this is the end of Remarkable. I'm here every Saturday evening from 11 p.m. to 1 a.m., bringing you only the latest and greatest in dance and club music. So tune in next Saturday night, and I will be back on the airwaves, spinning it up, and who knows what I'll be playing, but definitely worth checking out. You listen to WPRK 91.5 FM, the voice of Rollins College, broadcasting from Winter Park. This is Remark, over and out. Good night. You guys have a good week.
It's 1 a.m., and Mark is heading out to the club at Firestone. Although a lot of people are in bed by now, the night is young for the dance music crowd. Very young. You must be at least 18 to get into Firestone and have as much as $20 in your wallet. At 3 a.m., the doors finally open for the late night crowd. I'd love to film a party inside, but cameras are not allowed. Firestone is a gay club, but given what's been happening lately in the local politics, I can think of a more consequential explanation. In April of 1997, Florida's Republican legislature passed the anti-rave bill, banning nightclub owners from using their establishments during the hours in which liquor sales are prohibited. It was an effort to stop all-night dance parties, which many politicians were convinced had become hubs of drug use. All Orlando clubs would have had to shut down at 2 a.m. if not for an amendment that John Marsha single-handedly lobbied for in the state capitol. John is the owner of the club at Firestone. The amendment he fought for allowed local governments to opt out. Orlando, for instance, already had its own laws allowing clubs to stay open as late as they wanted. The state law wouldn't affect our city, so most of us didn't pay much attention. Clearly, though, the measure hinted at a rising anti-rave sentiment, fueled by sensationalist TV specials and other media reports. From personal experience, I knew that the reports were exaggerated. But how could elderly couples and young families driving past Firestone on their way to church know any better? The sweaty, sleepy-eyed kids they see emerging from the club probably do appear stoned. How long before these segments of the general public begin pressuring City Hall to put an end to raves? Ultimately, Firestone's refusal to let me film made perfect sense. If I somehow captured somebody swallowing a pill, the politicians and the media would have a field day.
Here at Underground Records, we sell everything from 12-inch vinyl, which of course is rare these days in most parts of the country, to compact discs, import CDs, domestic CDs, import and domestic 12-inches, as well as clothing, club clothing and club styles and stuff, stickers, cassette tapes from mixtapes from DJs, as well as record bags, DJ accessories, headphones, needles. It goes on and on. Just all sorts of things to basically set up the DJ for what he needs.
Mark works at Underground Record Source, the biggest dance music store in town. Working here allows him to keep up with the newest music in a genre that gets very little publicity and airplay. Dance music is definitely becoming more popular, but most tracks are still released in vinyl and in very limited numbers. If you don't buy a record when it's released, chances are you'll have a hard time ever getting hold of it again.
Records vary as far as price. When it comes to American domestic labels, probably $6 to $7 a record is usually the cost. Imports are usually $10 to $11 to $12 depending. I mean, for example, this record, which is an import right now, just came out this week, is $11.99, and you only get three tracks on the whole thing, one of which is like a 12-minute long song, so it's almost like a dollar a minute in some cases for how much you're paying for. The turntable, you're looking at $450 each. As far as the needles are concerned, it depends on what kind you get, anywhere from $150 or up. And of course you need a mixer too, and mixers can be anywhere from $100 to $800. For the complete DJing set, you'd need two turntables, a mixer, and two needles, and your headphones. So you're looking at about $1,000 or $1,200 on a really good system setup if you get everything brand new.
Recordings of all types of dance music are available from all over the world. The music is so international, in fact, there's little consensus in classifying it. In Orlando, we call the major categories house, techno, trance, funky breaks, and drum and bass. When Remark spins at Icon, he's spinning primarily house. Remark has a trademark. Every time he spins, he leaves the DJ booth at least once to dance for the crowd. Mark is the absolute best thing that could have happened to my documentary. Not only is he getting me clearance to film inside clubs, stores, and radio stations, he's doing something else no less important, revealing the scene behind the scene.
Mark was a very good child, very good boy, not interested in sports or whatever, more interested in the arts, drawing, music, very much so music.
Oh, I guess when we moved here and he was in his early teens and MTV had just come on the scene, so he was watching it quite a bit.
Always had a radio, boombox, but he really preferred the stereo playing his own music. He liked what he liked. He didn't particularly like everything on the radio, but he'd like I said, he'd want to play his own music. Cool. I think Mark had a trouble adolescence. I think he needed to express himself, which, as you probably know, he went into the wild hairdo. He started dressing
punk rock,
black. But Mark and I were always able to communicate. His head was still the same. He wasn't into drugs, he wasn't into alcohol, he wasn't into smoking or anything. Just doing his thing with his clothes and his hair. No, she's giving you a Caesar recipe.
Oh, there's Caesar.
My thoughts on Mark's professional future in the DJing and the musical industry, I worry about it. Mark is so intelligent. I think sometimes all this intelligence is going to waste, spinning records. However, I do feel that Mark knows his limitations. He knows he's probably only, you know, this business isn't going to last forever. His dad and I hope he goes back to school, gets his doctorate degree in philosophy, and teaches philosophy at a college someday. That's originally what he wanted to do. As long as Mark's happy, I guess that's all we really want.
Before I left, Mark's mom showed me where his bedroom had been.
When Mark had this room, let's see, about the time 13, he decided he was going to fix the room the way he wanted to. So he actually painted the room black, had white triangles all over the walls, posters, huge posters all over the walls. We still have lots of Mark's records. This closet, as you can see, is just all back in here. This is all records. Mark has a fortune tied up in records. And when Mark moved out, then we did paint the walls. I didn't want a black room anymore.
Neither did Mark. The bedroom in his apartment is almost all white, reflecting a life redirection that is also apparent in his shift in musical tastes.
These are all the CDs I have, all the different stuff, of course in alphabetical order, which is part of my, I guess, perfectionist kind of personality. I rarely listen to house music at home because I'm around it so much, either in the clubs or out at work, in my car half the time. I'm listening to so much dance music all the time, and so whenever I'm not around work and not around DJing, I try not to listen to dance music at all.
Mark shares the apartment with a few roommates who know a different side.
I met him at Visage. I met him at Visage nightclub when he was a freak with a... Actually, he wasn't very freaky back then, because when I finally met him, he was kind of like out of that punk rock freaky stage. But anyway, so he was dancing, and his dance is unlike anybody's that I've ever seen. And he just had so much energy, and he was just so in tune and in sync with the music, and it was just really cool. And the whole floor cleared for him when he would get on stage, and when he dances now, the whole floor just clears for him, and it's like he's out there just performing. It's crazy.
Massage has been closed for several years, but an opportunity has come up to watch Mark spin old wave like he did in the early days.
Thank you.
80s music is well received in Orlando. It's 90s music that isn't always so popular. Submitting to pressure, Glenda Hood, the mayor of Orlando, has joined the push to squeeze out raves. She has appointed a task force to study local clubs and review the city's policies allowing them to stay open all night. Traditional raves, however, aren't liquor licensed. Regulating them would be more like infringing on people's constitutional rights of expression and assembly.
How you guys doing? Good, I was supposed to go on like 15 minutes ago, but it's all good. I guess the turntables aren't even hooked up.
No.
The party's being put together by some German guy. I'm not really quite sure what his name is, but apparently he has not put things together in the right fashion. As a matter of fact, he's supposed to be DJing, 15 minutes ago. And they haven't even done the sound checks yet for the group that's performing live today. So I don't know if or when I'm going to be going on today.
It's the 4th of July, and Mark has been booked to spin at a rave called Independence. I've never been to a rave before, so I'm very excited to join him. As it turns out, it's kind of a new experience for him, too.
This is the very first rave that's been put together that's actually started in the morning and going to go all day through the nighttime. Normally, raves start, of course, at night and go all the way until the morning, so this is the first time that it's happened in reverse. And the people that put the party together were betting on the fact that people were going to be coming over here still partying from the night before at some other parties, and they're going to come over here and go all day. But I don't know if that's going to happen or not, because a day rave, you got to deal with the sun, you got to deal with the heat, you got to deal with a lot of other things that nighttime, you know, doesn't have. So anyway, hopefully it'll be somewhat of a success, but I really don't know.
Check, 1, 2, check. Check.
Although politicians and the media keep referring to the Orlando late nights as raves, the only thing Firestone and a rave have in common is dance music. Raves are typically attended by all age groups, so no alcohol is sold. They also draw a lot more people than clubs, which is why they tend to be held in warehouses or outdoors.
Hey, check. Okay, Ronnie.
The dog you're about to hear should appear to come from the left loudspeaker only.
Independence Rave is expecting 5,000 guests at $15 each. Raves don't have permanent addresses, so they're promoted rather than owned. And because no liquor license is needed, rave promoters are less likely than club owners to hire appropriate security and emergency medical personnel.
All right, it's now 9:30 in the morning, and we're getting the second sound check from the second group that's going to be performing today. I was supposed to go on at 8 a.m. and I'm supposed to be getting done with my set at 10 a.m. And so now that it's 9:30 and we're just about to do the second sound check, I don't think I'm going to be going on today at all. So that's the update as of right now on this 4th of July celebration.
Yeah.
So the big question now is, am I going to get paid? And if so, when? And if so, how much?
With a promoter nowhere in sight, Mark has no choice but to wait. In fact, everyone seems to be waiting for something. Very few people actually know what they're doing.
Well, at parties, I charge $25 for any piercing. It includes the jewelry. We make our own jewelry, so our prices can be as low as $10.
Portfolio. And basically, he'll start.
This is where he started piercing him down his spine. This navel is pierced 4 times. Up the loops. And that's her face, that's her prom picture.
Well, if someone wants their genitals pierced, then they would have to expose themselves on the bed, of course. And if they don't mind other people watching, then, you know, I would be able to perform the genital piercing.
Hold on. He can't possibly perform genital piercing in public. Well, we are talking raves.
Police or security, they give me no problems whatsoever. I've had a few problems in Atlanta with the genital piercings. Actually, they kind of kicked me out, so yeah. Generally, it's not a problem, though, to perform genital piercings at a party.
Anyway, Mark has to go to work soon, so time is running out. Finally, somebody spots the promoter outside. Mark is not the only DJ looking for him.
Alright, you too, man. Take care.
It's now 10:20 in the morning, and I was supposed to spin until 10. Didn't get a chance to play at all, and like I thought, getting paid was a problem. Since I didn't perform, the promoter is telling me that he doesn't know when he's going to be able to pay me. He wants to see how the day pans out first, and I didn't do a formal contract with this promoter, unfortunately, just because things were rushed. So because of that, now I don't have anything in writing saying that he needs to pay me. So I'm really not quite sure what I'm going to do about that. I guess I'm going to go make a few phone calls to see if I can get the money that is owed to me for coming out here and spending close to 3 hours waiting around for nothing. So I guess it's just what comes with the game. Is Remark. You're tuned into WPRK 91.5 FM, the voice of Rollins College, broadcasting from Winter Park, Florida. And I'm here every Saturday night from 11 o'clock to 1 a.m. bringing you the latest and greatest in dance and club music, as always.
Dance music has elevated disc jockeying to a new level. Not only is the dance music DJ responsible for selections, he has to mix the music artistically.
When DJing, the whole process is actually to try to mix two records together to get them sequenced together beats per minute wise, which means we got to speed things up or slow things down on each turntable. These turntables are designed to do that. They have pitch control, which means you can speed the pitch up or slow it down to make the beats match. Right now I've got a record playing on the left turntable, which is what the dance floor would normally be hearing out in a club, let's say, and on the right turntable I've got a record queued up, which is what the DJ would be hearing in the headphones. It's queued up on the first count right there. That's what the DJs needed to be queued up on when they're actually going to do the mix. And you need to wait for the one count to come in on the left turntable in order to actually do the mix. So the DJ would be listening to the right turntable in the headphones on the left ear while listening to what's going on the dance floor with the right ear, or actually listening to a monitor. And that's how he listens to see how the mix is going to take place. So the music is going to come in right now. And we're going to go ahead and do the mix. What I'm doing over here is pitching this record up, which means I'm speeding it up to match the left turntable. I'm giving it little pushes while I'm also increasing the pitch in order to get the rhythms to match. Sometimes it takes a long time for the DJ to do this. But fortunately, most house records are made with what's called the mix-in and the mix-out. In other words, the records are designed to be mixed together, and they'll have a long period of beats or rhythms or sequences at the beginning and at the end in order to make the mix easier. And these two sound good so far. So I'm going to go ahead and start the record back over again. And I've got the record on one again. Keeping in mind that the dance floor is only hearing out what's coming out of the left turntable, and the DJ hears what's going on the right. You also need to, a lot of times, to mix in the right spot in order to make the mix sound really smooth and really clean. And sometimes that takes a while to figure out what the right spot is to mix at. The right spot on this record is coming up right here. Now, the rhythm is going to be only on the right side now. And over on the left turntable, all we've got is the noise. That simple sound right there. The right turntable's got the rhythm. So when you're on the dance floor, the music keeps going. And this song's about to end. And this record's gonna keep going. And here goes the end of this record. Right here. And now
now the DJ will just crossfade over into the right turntable, and the process starts all over again. We've got this record over here now playing. The DJ picks up the needle on the left turntable, takes the record off, and picks another one, and keeps going through, and you just go back and forth, keeping the beat constant the whole time.
Tonight, Mark has invited a popular local DJ to appear on his radio show. Stylus, as he's called, is promoting his newest record. He's got his own ideas on what makes a DJ great.
Things that make a great DJ would be being able to select good music, being able to mix them properly, knowing your records, where every detail, where every change is, knowing where you can throw stuff and where you shouldn't, you know, when it's too much or whatever. Being able to move the crowd is most important. The crowd responds from the music the DJ is playing. They get energy from what he's doing. In turn, the DJ gets energy from the crowd when he sees them picking up the pace. They're starting to get more live, jumping. You know, sometimes you might have to play stuff that you might not care for just to keep the crowd going, though. You know, stuff on a more commercial tip, for example.
Chiefly, two types of dance music characterize the Orlando scene: progressive house and the sound that Stylus produces and plays, funky breaks.
Here at Cyberzone a couple of times. It's a really cool place, kind of different actually. Played here a couple of times, and now they pretty much specialize in sticking to the funky breaks and trip-hop kind of format, and it gets really busy because a lot of kids want to come out and hear that kind of stuff. Probably Saturday nights is their busiest night, and they have a lot of DJs who play the funky breaks. It took a while for it to get off the ground, but now it's actually Orlando's only bottle club where they can serve alcohol all night long, bring your own alcohol. Curfew is really going to be too effective when it comes to curbing the drug use. It's just going to cause people to take drugs and other intoxicants in different locations. If they're not taking it downtown at all night clubs, the places stay open all the time, that, you know, have liquor licenses, they're going to relocate to places like this perhaps, and they'll be able to do lots of drugs if they want inside. In addition to drinking all night, I mean, they'll be able to bring their own bottle and drink inside all night. So I don't think necessarily the curfew is going to have a too strong of an effect on curbing at least the drug use or the drug circulation in Orlando. It's just going to kind of relocate it and make the kids and go other places.
The curfew that Mark is referring to is one of the rules suggested by the Rave Task Force to cut down on the alleged drug abuse in clubs. These rules were all accepted unanimously by the city council, except the 4 a.m. curfew. The six commissioners split evenly. Half thought 4 a.m. was still too late, but the others felt closing nightclubs so early would force raves into non-liquor licensed establishments, exacerbating the drug problem. Mayor Hood was called upon to break the tie. On July 21st, the council voted 4-3 to pursue an ordinance closing all city bars and clubs by 3 a.m. But with two public hearings necessary before an ordinance can become law, the stage was set for citizens on both sides of the fence to defend their positions.
I think more than just the raise, it's just the drug use. They see the drug use, and they can't really look past that at the music and what it's really about. All they see is a bunch of kids getting messed up.
The clubs are gonna lose a lot of business. Sometimes when I don't get off of work until midnight, I can go there because I know I can stay until 4 or 5 o'clock.
It's just gonna force it out in outside of the downtown area where they have no control over it, and drug activity is just gonna flourish.
City Hall has justified the proposed ordinance by claiming there is drug abuse in the late night club scene. But instead of targeting criminals, the mayor's crusade appears satisfied with just shutting down clubs. I meant to ask Mayor Hood for an explanation, but she wouldn't grant me an interview. Neither would any of the commissioners supporting the curfew.
I think that this is a problem that needs to be addressed, needs to be faced head on and attempted to be solved, as opposed to trying to eliminate it from our community, but not address it and solve the problem.
Commissioner Bill Bagley opposes the curfew. He represents District 4, which includes the downtown area.
According to the information that's presented to us, the vast majority of participants at all-night dance parties are not using mind-altering substances. And we shouldn't deny them the right to their activities simply because of a small minority.
Located just across the street from the club at Firestone, the city's biggest newspaper has consistently tied the clubs to drug abuse. It has rarely had anything redeeming to say about Orlando's dance music scene.
Orlando Sentinel in particular appears, from my perspective, to slant their articles in a manner where editorializing within their articles is quite common, and they are, in fact, they have taken an editorial position against continuing all-night dance parties. And it's, in my opinion, rather evident from the news reporting that this is the position that they are taking and that they are promoting.
The powerful lobbying of Orlando's tourism industry has secured a curfew exemption for theme park clubs and bars. Because Disney and Universal are expanding their night entertainment complexes, many locals fear the curfew will put downtown business owners at a huge disadvantage.
Well, it seems to me that the mayor and the members of the city council were doing everything in their power not too long ago to get people to go to downtown Orlando. Then finally, some young entrepreneurs get it together. They go to downtown Orlando. They start opening clubs and saloons and bars and all that kind of stuff. People by the thousands begin to flock to downtown Orlando because that's the place to be. And then what happens? The mayor comes along with her cronies, and they do everything in their power to put an end to it.
David Simonu, owner of Icon in Cairo, is a case in point.
I think the ordinance over the weekend on Friday and Saturday night probably will decrease our business between 20% to 30%. But that remains to be seen.
People usually go to clubs after already having been to a bar or restaurant. David worries that they might stop coming altogether if the curfew forces them to go home earlier.
I would rather see at 4 a.m. because I think you need a couple of hours for the people to still hang around, be able to dance after 2 a.m. I think 3 o'clock is a little bit too early, but still the city commissioners and the mayor made that decision, which hopefully will help the health issue and the safety of the people that come to downtown.
Walking past the empty DJ booth, I felt like I was experiencing an eerie preview of the clubs after the curfew passed.
I don't know if it's because of the jobs that people work or the tourism or what, but people are just ready to go out and dance and have a good time. It's a really uplifting, happy feeling. People don't go out angry. They come out to the clubs to have a good time, and you know, they come out to dance. And so there's always been a good thing going on in Orlando.
As owner of Underground Record Source, Robbie Clark is one of the true forefathers of Orlando dance music. He's also the resident DJ at Firestone, the club that will be most affected by the curfew.
Firestone's a house music club. We're still bringing guest DJs, and they would probably perform earlier. I would probably open for them and play till 12 o'clock, and they would go on and play from 12 to 3. But I think that Firestone plans on being open and open even after the ordinance. They plan on fighting it and keeping their doors open.
Robbie has helped launch a small anti-curfew campaign at the store. They have posted a sign and are handing out flyers, urging patrons to fight to keep the clubs open. Interestingly, a number of people within the dance music scene support the ordinance. They feel the clubs have commercialized the scene, and they wish it would go back to the underground.
I have to say that I'm definitely in favor of the ordinance. I've been going out for about a little over 2.5 years now to late night club scene. I've seen it consistently going down as far as in quality, the people and the nights. And
Doug Richards, another local DJ and an employee at the store, agrees with the city leaders that the club scene is suffering a major drug problem.
I hope the ordinance will make people more aware of what they are doing, what they've been doing, what they're like, where they're going, and it'll just make them think more. I think, you know, it's almost like, I wouldn't think of it as a punishment, but it's definitely somebody, you know, pulling the reins back and saying, wait a minute, you know, you're not doing things right now.
Mark definitely is against the curfew. will force him to stop spinning much earlier. But that is not the only reason.
Open all night. I mean, that's not really my concern about dancing all night. I'm more concerned about them closing at 3 a.m. when you've got a club filled with all these drunkards who could be emptying out on the streets right then at 3 o'clock. And I would personally like to see it pushed back till about 4 or 5 a.m.
Yeah, that's a good idea, because even if you stay up until 4 or 5, you stop serving alcohol at 2, it gives people time to sober up in the club. It makes no sense to me when clubs close their doors at 2:01.
Oh, exactly.
And these people have been slamming drinks until 1:55. You know,
exactly.
That doesn't make any sense.
And even still, at 3 o'clock in the morning, they're still going to be wasted enough. And I personally know that I like to have my music going until 4 to get them dancing still and drinking water, and then they can leave at 4, and I feel better knowing that the club, you know, gave them ample time to sober up. So,
a very responsible
decision. That makes a lot of sense.
Appreciate it, Remark.
Come hang out.
Later on.
Peace. 916-1041-888.
This is going to be a really unique edition of Remarkable. Later on tonight, I'm going to be having a very special guest here in the studio from the Orlando Weekly. Jeff Truesdale is going to be here. He is the Orlando Weekly editor, and he's going to be talking with us tonight about what's going on with the rave bill, which I'm sure all of you are aware of.
Most of the arguments against the 3 a.m. curfew are well-reasoned, yet city council insists that the late-night drug problem can't be ignored. What makes their crusade suspicious, though, is that it doesn't move beyond simply shutting down clubs. Could there possibly be another motive behind the curfew? If so, Jeff Truesdell might know. As editor of Orlando's second largest newspaper, he's been following the controversy from the beginning.
I don't think there's a controversy, frankly, so much about the whether it's 3, 3:30, 4 o'clock. The controversy focuses very directly on whether or not the clubs can stay open, whether or not the rave scene as it exists in Orlando will be allowed to continue. Orlando, obviously a very image-conscious community. That image consciousness extends very much to the downtown area, if you will, to the aesthetics of the area. In Orlando, what you have, quite frankly, the downtown area is a beautiful area, well-policed, well-maintained, very closely and cleverly manicured, well-lit, very safe. And it's quite deliberate. For much of the world, because of Disney World, Orlando is the face of America, and the city leaders are well aware of that fact. And so they will go out of their way, perhaps to extremes, to police an image that they think is safe and desirable. The discussion a few years back of a teen curfew plays directly into what we're seeing now, I believe, with the rave ordinance. When we were gearing up to host World Cup soccer in Orlando, the teen curfew sort of came out of nowhere, if you will, masqueraded as a youth protection ordinance. And it was not really so much an effort to keep teens at home or protect them from dangers as it was a clean sweep of spiky-haired kids with tattoos and pierces out of the very heavily patrolled tourist district of downtown. I'm sure you remember that very well. It is the type of thing I think that we're beginning to see now with the rave ordinance as well.
To Jeff, the rave ordinance is an attempt to protect the pristine reputation of the city beautiful. According to his paper, Mayor Hood recently had shown the city council a photograph of a Berlin rave that drew hundreds of thousands of people. She'd asked the commissioners to think about what they wanted their downtown to represent.
Rave, the word rave has had a rough go in this country since if you look back in the history, late 80s, it sort of moved over from the UK and came over to this country and was almost immediately tagged with a negative connotation by the mainstream media. Well, the tough thing that the city council hasn't really wrestled with, rave is not an event. Rave, as you discussed, rave is a scene. Rave is an attitude. Rave is a
subculture.
It's a subculture. It's music. It's visuals. It's a non-judgmental embrace of other people, for the most part. They should be spending some money to perhaps help beef up security. Take those 10 police officers who stand at every street corner to police jaywalking and put them in the clubs late at night. You're going to be much more effective in that regard than you are in essentially shutting down what you believe to be a drug hangout.
August 11th brought the first of two public hearings on the ordinance. Not too many people from the dance music scene have shown up. It's a Monday, and of course, many of them, including Mark, had to be at school or at work. The mayor and the commissioner zip through a full agenda until they reach City Code Sections 33.01. Then things really slow down, because nearly everyone in the audience has something to say.
We put a lot of emphasis on protecting the children of those ages, but yet, one of the most devastating things for the young people today is there availability of drugs?
There's no surprise in the commissioner's opinions. They've been familiar since the original vote to pursue the curfew. Don Ammerman, Knapp Ford, and Betty Wyman have joined forces with Mayor Hood for a 3 a.m. shutdown. Opposing are Bill Bagley, Ernest Page, and Bruce Gordy. There are no surprises in the audience comments either. Those opposed argue that the perception of a drug problem is overblown. They think that forcing the scene underground will be counterproductive. And those in support, mainly mothers of troubled kids, urge the council to help them control their children. The club owners, standing to lose a lot of money, restate their willingness to compromise with the 4 a.m. curfew. The surprise comes when Firestone's attorney pulls out the latest issue of Rolling Stone. It features an article about the Orlando dance music scene. Rolling Stone releases its 97 hot issue, and Orlando is lauded as the Seattle of dance music. Here's a 6-page article praising Orlando's innovative musicians, top-grade DJs, and what it calls the best techno club in the Southeast, the club at Firestone. The timing is perfect.
And I think this quote from Rolling Stone is very flattering. It says that every generation needs a private language that people over 30 can translate. It says, these days, that lingo is coming from Orlando. The eyes of the nation are upon the music scene here. I would say that we should be proud of the national reputation that we're developing downtown as a cutting edge for arts throughout the nation. We shouldn't stifle it, we should study it, we should support it, we should police it, we should regulate it, but we shouldn't try to close it down.
Rave grunge apparently isn't the look Mayor Hood and half the council have envisioned for Orlando. So the Rolling Stone article leaves them unmoved.
It was based on the fact that there is a confirmed, ongoing, uncontrollable drug problem in the rave clubs. It's time to put some controls in place, and this is one way of doing it.
Orlando may soon see the last of those all-night dance parties called raves. The city council voted this afternoon to force clubs to shut their doors at 3 a.m. Right now, the clubs and bars can stay open all night if they wish to, but they do have to stop serving alcohol at 2. City officials hope to put an end to the drug problem they say is associated with those all-night raves.
What my client does from now is the first thing we do is we continue to try to convince these people to at least reconsider and go back and look at the task force. Their own findings don't support what they're doing. Their own findings go absolutely the opposite. Law enforcement itself says that by driving this out of the downtown area could be dangerous to our youth.
Everyone knows who the man behind the club at Firestone is, but very few of us have actually met him.
Do you know others in the area? Was this, first of all, a surprise to you?
No. This has been going on for months. My biggest disappointment is coming in that the city seems to be cloaking what is a cosmetic issue in a public safety issue or a drug issue. And clearly their own police department and their own experts presented to the task force have shown that the percentage of drugs that is seen in my club late at night is the same percentage of drugs seen in the community of that demographic, people of that age. So clearly there is no perceivable drug problem any different than we have in society, unfortunate as that may be. So if they're gonna call us a cosmetic issue, let's call it what it is. If they don't like the way it looks, I'm sorry.
Before the curfew, John Marsa had kept to himself. He seemed unwilling to share the spotlight with his club's popularity. But with the city council poised for a final action, John decides to reach out and build up support for the cause.
And tonight, in continuing on with my support of trying to keep clubs open, I'm gonna have John Marsa, the owner of Firestone, down here a little bit later. I hope he will be arriving in about half an hour, and we'll probably talk to him at the top of the next hour, around midnight or so.
With hardly more than a week remaining before the second hearing, John stops by the radio show and shares some stories, including how he first heard of the state rave bill.
8 months ago now. It was a phone call from a Sentinel reporter covering state legislation, and she asked me what I thought about this upcoming proposed rave bill. I had no idea what she was talking about, and during the conversation, she was fishing for information, and I said, look, I've got nothing to hide. There's no problems at my club. There's, you know, drugs aren't tolerated. There's no open use. It's not a serious problem. And then she said, well, why then do you advertise drugs on your flyers? And of course, I had no idea what she was talking about. And digging deeper, it turned out she was talking about a crystal method flyer from 2 years before. And it was this expert's opinion, who was a captain of the beverage department in Tampa, who probably helped inspire the bill. self-proclaimed expert on raves. He seemed to think that crystal method must be some code name or not so code name for drugs. And further on the flyer talked about Logic Trance giveaways throughout the night, which of course were, you know, records and t-shirts and not some code for drugs. And that was the that was my drug promotion.
Mark takes the opportunity to bring up the Rolling Stone article.
I think it's phenomenal. I mean, it's got to be one of the quintessential compliments in the industry is to have an article in Rolling Stone magazine. And as much as maybe some of the people down at City Hall don't think it's a good thing, I think a six-page write-up on the music scene in Orlando is awesome for everybody in the industry.
Definitely.
Yeah, it's a good thing. There's several angles through which we're going to be looking at going after this ordinance, and not the least of which is going to be more obvious things like petitions from downtown business owners and obviously as many people that can show up downtown on September 8th at 2 p.m. Is going to be a really good thing. We'd like to fill those seats with supporters.
Hope you enjoyed this edition of Remarkable. Thanks again goes out to John Marsa, the owner of the club at Firestone, who came down tonight to talk to us on the radio show, give us some insight into what was going on as far as his club is concerned and the proposed ordinance of closing down clubs here in Orlando at 3 a.m. So thanks again for him to come out and kind of talk to us. And as always, you need to get down there and show your support for keeping late night clubs open. And of course, Zen Festival is tomorrow, and a lot of great acts over there. Sasha, John Digweed, Josh Wink, Kiyoki, Goldie, really big party. So have fun out there. Be safe as always, and have a great Labor Day weekend. This is Remark, over and out.
On Labor Day Sunday, a lot of out-of-town visitors pass through Underground Records. They take their time checking out the clothes and listening to the records, but the store is clearly not what they have come to Orlando for.
Zen. It's everywhere, all over the internet, TV, radio, flyers everywhere.
Big party, good music.
Flyers all over Chicago. Just a two-day trip, party, go home, crash.
Zen is a rave in its third straight year. Last year's drew 12,000, and this year's promises to be even bigger. It boasts an impressive lineup of superstar DJs. Zen is being promoted nationwide with flashy flyers, websites, and commercial spots on MTV. Publicity at home has been free. Local newspapers are writing it up, pointing out how frivolous the rave ordinance is when it can do nothing to stop a rave like Zen. In spite of my poor experience with raves in the past, I've decided to give it another try. I'm going to Zen too. The scenery and atmosphere at Zen is like a year 2000 Woodstock. Themes of spirituality and brotherly love correspond well to the idealistic character of dance music. Zen is open to ages 16 and up. There is no alcohol, but plenty of money is being made off water being sold for the price of beer. There is plenty of 90s commercialism and activism in this rave of the new millennium. In fact, there are as many product stands and activist posts as there are police officers. Next to the Greenpeace stand, I found some familiar faces. Incidentally, I haven't seen any genital piercing at Zen. This year, Zen is taking place at the Polk County Fairgrounds, a few miles west of Orlando. Promoters have put up several large tents. Each has its own lineup of DJs playing a specific type of dance music. The prominence of dance music in the Sunshine State is evidenced by a tent devoted solely to Florida DJs. Headlining DJs spin at the main stage or inside the auditorium. The overwhelming number of police officers at Zen seems unjustifiable. Raves are rarely marred by violence. You're much more likely to receive a hug than a shove. And as far as drugs are concerned, the people who want to use them still do, just not in the open. The massive police presence seems to be the work of politicians, wanting to let everybody know that, although they can't shut Zen down, they will certainly try to spoil the party. But as long as there are more of these than those, and the music is playing, the party goes on as scheduled, till the very end. It's 8 o'clock in the morning, and I'm going home. It's been exactly 14 hours since I arrived here, but I'm leaving early. In spite of Zen's success, what has made the headlines is the huge police presence, and the fact that one of the promoters was arrested for illegal possession of a drug. With but a week remaining before the final vote, if Zen and Rolling Stone haven't changed anyone's mind, it is difficult to imagine what will.
I think it'd probably be a good idea to shut it down, close it early, keep the kids out of trouble, keep them out of getting into things that they shouldn't.
I really don't see a need for them to be open that late. It seems like by that time in the morning, people would have had enough time to get all the enjoyment they need, and there's really no need for them to stay open that late, I wouldn't think.
Wouldn't make any difference to me either. I'm not out that late.
Until 4 a.m. might be the last time I might do it. I hope it'll be a really good night. I just really would like to keep spinning until 4 a.m. It really sucks if I gotta stop at 3 because I'm mostly concerned about all people who might be too drunk to leave at 3 a.m. if we shut the doors here every Friday at 3 o'clock from now on. So I'm really hoping we can stay open until 4. Hopefully it'll go through to where we can stay at least open until 4, and that way people can have a good last hour of dancing, drinking water, and having a good time, and that's all
just having a good time, so hope it'll be good.
Zim proved to me that raves can be fun, but I'd still rather experience dance music inside a club. Clubs are cleaner, the crowd is older, and the light and sound systems do more justice to the music. Clubs have a permanent address, too. If you become a regular, you can actually make some friends. Allied troops have invaded City Hall. It's a Monday again, but this time the dance music community showed up. The media has appeared in large numbers, too. Everyone knows that the future of dance music in Orlando is about to be decided. Mayor Hood seems to have anticipated both the media and the hostile crowd. She set up her line of defense with a deposition by the Orlando Chief of Police, who essentially designates late-night clubs as drug magnets. The council also hears early on from Representative John Maroney, the author of the original rave bill. He insinuates a strong connection between raves and Florida's increasing heroin use, but offers no hard statistics.
And many of those deaths were attributed to raves.
The Allied side presents their arguments, still valid, but no more effective than before the first vote. Something fresh is offered by Sean from WPRK. The council ought to break free from its Mickey Mouse mentality and treat Orlando as the cosmopolitan city it has become. Mark reaffirms his concern that the 3 a.m. curfew won't allow enough time for drinkers to sober up before driving home.
Thank you very much.
I saw a group of wholesome young adults that were having fun dancing. And I don't want to impede what is happening downtown. I want it to continue to grow, and I want it to be able to compete against Universal and Disney, keep it downtown.
The commissioners have nothing new to add either. Their minds seem made up. The meeting drags on for almost 2 hours, and everyone feels a perverse relief when it finally ends.
It was wrong.
This is Channel 6 News.
All-night dance parties may be a thing of the past in Orlando. Rave clubs are being slapped with a curfew, and it's not music to the ears of clubgoers. Good evening, everybody, and thanks for joining us. The late-night dancing is about to come to an end in downtown Orlando.
The month-long debate over raves has ended with the city council voting for clubs to shut their doors at 3 in the morning.
They're going to be taken to different places that aren't regulated, and they're going to die. And as far as I'm concerned, the city council bears all the responsibility. That's all I can say.
I think it's very sad because I believe that this will be detrimental to the young people in our community, and I think it's going to put a great number of young people at risk.
The parties will be elsewhere. It will be an unregulated, non-liquor license establishments, and I think everyone's pretty clear on that fact. I feel that it steps into the rights of business and adults in their private life, and I really don't think it was an appropriate measure, nor do I think it's going to be an effective measure. A band-aid at best.
It remains to be seen if Orlando starts to go out earlier. Right now, midnight is about the time that people start going out, you know, getting ready to go out, and it remains to see how long it's going to take for that to change to where people actually start going out at 11.
If that happens, that the raver kids or the late night kids start coming out earlier, usually they have voiced that they don't want to have anything to do with the drinking crowd, and that was why they preferred to be out late night after 3 a.m. when the drinking crowd had either filtered out or sobered up. So I think it'll be interesting to see how they react to having to be in their capacity, in their presence, having said that they, from many people, I've heard that they have no interest in being around that, and that's why they like raving late night.
Sean is right. It will be interesting to see how the late night crowd interacts with the drinking crowd. And as Mark suggested, it remains to be seen whether people will be willing to go out to the clubs earlier. Will the curfew contain or aggravate the drug problem? Will John Marsa find a way to keep the club at Firestone open? How will the entire Orlando dance music scene adjust to the curfew? These are great questions. And like everybody else, I'm anxious about the answers. But the time to turn off the camera has arrived. The documentary has fulfilled its mission. All of my filming has been a personal exploration. What attracts me and others to dance music? I think I have found the answer.
Probably the most important thing is the ability for house music to conjure up really strong emotions. I like other things too, the elements, the beats, the rhythms, the bass lines. I think there's a kind of subconscious kind of connection with everybody to some kind of dance music. Say going back to ancient times when people used to dance around fires or something.
When I hear a really good slamming house track, it does something to me that I absolutely get the chills. And whether it's that I'm having a good memory of some time that I've had when I've been out at a club, or something that incorporated another good feeling that I'm associating with that song, I have no idea where it comes from. But there's something about a really great house track that really physically makes you happy.
It's completely different from every other music that I ever listened to that I used to listen to in the past, and maybe some music that's around today that's not house music that I dig it, but it's not got the same feel, it's not got the same emotion for me. And being a DJ too, playing it and seeing people dance to it and have a good time and everything, that's for me probably what's the biggest thing.
It isn't easy to understand why dance music is so compelling. It's even harder to articulate it. I can take a feeble shot and say I'm attracted because it inspires my imagination. It uncovers emotions I never knew existed in my own underground. But those explanations aren't distinct enough. It's best I let the documentary speak for itself. I want to give something one last try before putting the camera away.
And of course tonight there's just an extra vibe of excitement in the air because, as many of you may know, late night clubbing as we know it in Orlando has come to an end. And I was fortunate enough to go down to the city council meeting this past Monday and witnessed the, local government in process, and was able to have my voice be heard in order to try to oppose this ordinance that has now gone into effect. And 2 weeks ago, I had John Marsa from the club at Firestone on my radio show, basically giving us the scoop on what was going on over there with Firestone and how they were going to be affected and by the ordinance if it passed, and how their club business would be affected. And I am fortunate enough to have Mr. Marsa back in the studios tonight to give us kind of like a follow-up and a general, I think, for everybody's support. And he's here tonight with me in the studios. So welcome, John.
I got to thank everybody out there for 4 great years of late night. I mean, the parties have been amazing. The support's been amazing. It's been fun for me. And it's my frame of mind that it's not gone, it's just gone for now. Mm-hmm. And I guess we'll see a lot of you guys out there tonight.
So I guess the big question on our minds is, when it passed, it had 10 days to take effect.
There's several legal avenues that our attorneys are discussing and looking at, but 10 days doesn't leave the opportunity for an injunction to stop what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. So we're operating and promoting and doing what we do with the knowledge that we will be closing at 3:00 in 10 days, making tonight our last late night Saturday.
I still haven't been able to film inside the club at Firestone. Now that I know John Marsa, though, maybe he'll let me film what may be the club's last late night ever. Wouldn't it be great if he said yes?
Thank you.